Hey everyone, Jill here. You're listening to a paranormal podcast dealing with death and ghosts. Here are a few content warnings for you. This week's episode deals with child death, overall themes of death, illness, train-related death, and hopefully that's it. We don't delve too deeply into these topics, but just letting you know. We have a Halloween special coming up and we need your stories to read on the podcast. Send us your spooky or unexplained stories to maritimesupernatural@gmail.com. You can send in a voice clip saying Happy Halloween, and we'll play it during our Halloween episode. The deadline is October 28th, so you better get it in quick. If you want to tweet at us, include the hashtag Spookening2019. That's Spookening, S-P-O-O-K-E-N-I-N-G, 2019. Thank you to Daniel Luke, who's composed our intro music, which you're about to hear. He's an incredible artist, animator, composer, and also an amazing person. You can find his work at webbot15.com. That is webbot15.com. I hope you enjoy our episode. Thanks for listening. Our Maritime Supernatural podcast.
That is us. This is episode 3.
Yeah, we're here to spookify you.
I just got excited about that. I just remembered. So yeah, it's been a while since we last recorded. The last time we recorded was September 1st.
Was it?
Yes. Yeah, I was listening to episode 2, and at one point we mentioned that it's September 1st.
Whoa.
So it's been over a month. It's been almost a month and a half at this point.
That's why we're so rusty.
Exactly, yes. But it shouldn't be too long between this episode and the next episode, because our next episode is going to be the Spookening.
Ooh.
Our Halloween / Chrissy's birthday special.
I'm so excited.
Yeah, no, I'm really excited for it. I have some ideas and I can't wait to run them by you.
Okay, we'll talk about that after.
Yes, we will. Yes. And yeah, when this episode comes out, I'm going to be in Disney World.
Ooh.
Yeah. So I'm super excited for that. It's my first time going to Disney World.
And all the Halloween stuff will be in full bloom.
Yeah. I still have to look up what events are going to be going on, because apparently you have to sign up for them beforehand.
Oh.
And I have not done that.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes, yeah. So I'm gonna be looking into that.
Perfect. Can't wait to hear about your trip.
I'm so excited, and I will bring back a present for you.
Yes. Oh my gosh, we should record me opening it.
Yes. We'll do that for the Spookening.
Okay. Perfect.
Yes. What is your favorite Disney movie?
Oh my gosh. Ask me any other question but the Moana, for sure, hands down.
Moana, okay, yeah. Oh, that's good. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of good Moana stuff there. Excellent, perfect.
I love Moana.
Moana.
I'm crying.
I know a girl from
Moana.
An island.
We listen to the Moana soundtrack all the time in our house. My partner also loves it. And whenever we're cooking or cleaning or anything, he always gets Alexa, the basically Google Home from Amazon, to play the Moana soundtrack while we're doing anything.
Yeah.
He initiates it. It's not me. So we're just
excellent.
Constantly listening to Moana. And if I listen too closely, I will cry.
Yes,
I can't help myself.
There was a good month after we saw the movie that was all we listened to.
Yes.
In my household.
Yes.
We could, it literally ruined all other music for us because we couldn't listen to anything else. I have it on my faves list on Spotify. So, of course, it comes up when I'm working.
Yes.
And the amount of times that, a coworker has looked over at me and I'm just, crying and, singing along silently. They're listening to Moana again.
There they go.
There they go.
Listening to Moana.
Yes. I'm so excited for Moana. Also, the Star Wars park will be open by the time we get there.
Oh my gosh! Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Holy moly! I am coming along in your suitcase.
Yes, hop in. Here we go. I don't have a suitcase, so you'll be left at home.
Oh no!
Oh no! Not again.
I tried.
Yeah. And I'm also excited. This is so silly. I'm so excited to go to Target to be able to like buy some of the really cool Halloween stuff I've seen online.
Yeah.
I'm going insane. I'm so bummed that Canada doesn't have Target anymore.
I know. The Target days were very short-lived up here.
Oh, they were short-lived, but they were beautiful.
They were.
Yeah. Especially when they were like closing around Christmas time. I got like a $300 tree for $70.
You clean up at the holidays.
Yep. Yeah. So, yeah, let's like jump into our story.
My story today, or I guess my research led me on this, and I'm going to be talking about forerunners. Have you ever heard of forerunners?
No, I haven't.
All right. Forerunners are a maritime, I think often Nova Scotian experience that...
Are they a cryptid?
No. It's an experience that some people have in which they experience a foretelling of death, sometimes of their own death. So you would have heard of the saying, like, when a bird hits your window and someone you know is about to die.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that can be considered a forerunner. Or if you hear, like, church bells ringing in the middle of the night when they're not supposed to. Or three knocks on the door.
Or, like, a blue butterfly or something.
Yeah, there's, like, a lot of different ones, okay? So these ones are a bit more in-depth. Than that.
Okay, nice.
So
okay.
I was doing some research online and I found a few of people who would be like walking on a road back in the day when it was all rocky roads. What are they before paved roads?
And yeah. So when you just had like the dirt roads and
Dirt roads. Yeah. That's the word I was looking for. So rocky roads. You can tell I'm always thinking about ice cream. Anyway.
Oh shit.
Always. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said something.
I do love Rocky Road. Thank you, Weird Al. Okay. Hi, welcome to our ice cream fan cast.
Yeah. We just talk about ice cream and I won't get into how it makes me feel the next day, but I'll talk about eating it all the
time. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so back when there were dirt roads, there might still be this sort of superstition, but they say not to walk down the middle of a road at night, or you might come across like a funeral procession. So there's multiple stories of people who would be walking down the road, down the middle of the road, and they'd feel this oppressive sensation, like just this kind of energy just oppressing them. And they'd kind of find it hard to breathe and they'd kind of struggle a bit. And then they'd walk to the side of the road. And then some of them would hear like horse clopping on the road or like the sound of a wagon wheeling by, and they'd kind of know that it was a funeral procession. Like they'd get this feeling, this sensation that they just know what it is. And then the next day someone would die, or the next day like a funeral would happen or something like that on that same
really
street. Yes. So there were multiple stories like that. And then there was another forerunner, which is hearing a coffin being built in the middle of the night. And then the next day, like, a child would pass away. Like, the child was sick. And then the next day, the child would pass away. And then the sound was, you know, the grandfather making the coffin. Because back then, they didn't buy the coffin.
The family would. Yeah. How would you know it's a coffin being built?
I think part of forerunners is that you instinctively
know
what it is. So it's not just that you see or hear something. It's that you get this feeling that you know what it is. Because, like, you might hear someone building something, or you might get, walk through a stink cloud or something. But the fact is that these people were feeling this, and that's what attached it as a forerunner versus just this, you know, strange sensation. Like, I think knowing what it means is part of what makes it a forerunner.
Okay, all right.
There's a story that was taking place in Cape Breton where they would see this train driving by at the shore, but they couldn't hear it, which is very weird because, as you know, trains are very loud.
Mm-hmm.
So they, some of the people would go down and stand there and wait because it was very on time. Every day, say 7 p.m., it would drive by. So people would go down to investigate and see what is going on because it wasn't on schedule. And the people that were near the tracks wouldn't see anything. But the people up higher in the town, the people up higher in the town would still see it going along the tracks and everything. But the people actually down close couldn't see it, couldn't hear it. There was nothing.
Oh, that gave me shivers. Yeah. Oh, wow. That's super spooky.
So then a month later, a man was killed by a train at that time on those tracks.
Huh.
Yeah. So they took that as a forerunner. So.
Wow.
Yeah. So there are a few like that. And then there's one a little bit more friendly that I found that was a bit more recent. And this was in the Kings County News. So it was an article by Wendy Elliott, and the news story was about a miner's daughter named Glenda. So we're back on miners. I think if you listened to last week, we talked a lot about miners because it's a very, like, coal mining was very popular in the Maritimes. So a miner's daughter, her father started working in the mines at only 11. The father of the household went out west and never came back. Like, he just abandoned the family. So the oldest son, so this woman's father, he was only 11, and he had to start working in the coal mine.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked last week about pit ponies and everything. So she doesn't know what his job was in the mine, but she did know that there was a huge connection between her father and these horses down in the mine. One morning at 3 a.m., she woke up, and there was this horse running down her street and just taking off and having a great time, this brown horse. And she
was it having a great time or was it spooked? Because it sounds like something that would spook a horse.
Maybe it was spooked. Maybe it was a terrified horse. But she seemed to feel that it was having a good time or whatever.
Okay, so reportedly she was like, no, it was happy. It was in good spirits.
I think so. That's the sensation I got when I was reading it. I could read it again and be like, oh, it actually says here that the horse was absolutely terrified and it ran into a fence. I don't remember that. But I think it seemed like the horse was fine. It was just kind of trotting down this street. And then she found out that her father had passed away at the exact hour that she had woken up and saw this out her window. And she felt that it was a forerunner of the pit pony running to meet the young miner he bonded with all those years ago.
Oh.
Like, she took it as a forerunner, so she saw this at the same moment that her father passed away.
That's so cute.
She connected it as sort of a forerunner of his death.
Yeah.
Which I thought was kind of interesting because we also talked about horses last week. But maybe that was connected to the pit ponies, right?
Yeah, I think it's like mining and pit ponies and, you know, it's all connected. Hi, welcome to the Maritimes.
Yes, exactly. So this is a little excerpt from a book by Helen Crichton called Blue Nose Ghosts is the name of the book. And this was where I had first heard about forerunners. And I just wanted to kind of read this little excerpt here because I thought it was a pretty good and spooky example.
I do want to jump in here real quick for our listeners who are not from the East Coast. When people say blue nose around here, they are referring to a specific ship and not the ghosts have blue noses.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you look at the Canadian dime, that is the blue nose.
Yeah. It's a very common thing here, so I didn't even consider explaining it. But yeah, blue nose is one word, and it's the name of a ship. So by saying blue nose ghosts, we're getting a vibe of Maritimes, we're getting a vibe of ships and ghosts all in one.
Yes. So, continue with your reading. I apologize for interrupting.
No, that was a very good interjection. Okay, so this story, I'm going to start after these two young men were out together and they met in the middle, like between their two houses, to mail a letter, and then they stopped to have a chat. So they mailed a letter and then they sat alongside the road opposite a house and talked. It was a bright night with a full moon, and it was too nice to separate and go home early. The Riordan's grass was about 3 feet high at the time, and there was a turnip field behind it. We heard a hoe strike against a rock, and it attracted our attention. We sat forward and then looked, and to our surprise, we saw a thing come crawling on its hands and feet from the southeast corner of the house. Then it stood up, and we could see that it was a man. We were on the lower or south side of the road, and it was on the upper or north side. Then it went out of sight. In the country, we often think a lot without saying anything, and anyway, there's often no need of words between friends, so we just sat there and didn't say anything, and before long, it came back. We didn't move an inch, but we watched, and this time it came halfway across the road. The time for keeping quiet was over now, so I said, "Joe, did you see that?" He said, "Yes, he did," and by this time it had gone back again. You might think we'd had enough, but we kept still, and it didn't keep us waiting very long. The third time was like the others. It came out and went back. We still sat there, and in a second's time it was back, and it went under the cherry tree. There were more apple trees on our side of the road then than now, and they took to shaking, and the apples fell to the ground. I was frightened by this time, and I said, "Joe, I've got to go home." That would have been all right if we'd both lived in the same direction. Probably we'd have left even before that, but we were braver together. We decided to go to Joe's house, and we started to run. Joe wasn't very strong, but he always thought he could run, and he could, and I was afraid I couldn't keep up with him. I guess the fear got into my feet because I ran just as fast as he did. When we got to his house, we stood in the road and talked. We were young men and curious, and we didn't like to leave it there because it would always pester us, and we'd never know what we'd seen. It didn't seem like a prank, but if it was, we wanted to settle it. Finally, I said, "Let's go back. I'm not afraid." I wasn't either, so long as Joe was with me. Nothing was going to hurt the two of us, and besides, it's easy to be brave when you have company. "We'll see what it is," I said. So we walked back, and pretty soon we saw it, and it was coming to meet us. It was halfway between the Riordans and the Croans, and that's the next house and the one in between. I said, "There it is. Don't leave me." As I said, I figured that with two of us, it couldn't do much harm, and I went to find out what it was. I meant to touch it, and then I'd know for sure if it was real. When we were within 20 feet of it, I said again, "Joe, don't leave me." And when I walked up till my face was close beside it, I'll never forget that moment as long as I live. It had on black pants, a white shirt with a hard bosom front, and black braces. Its head was bare, and it was of medium size. It looked as though its eyes were deeply sunk in, and they were bright and penetrating, and the only thing it looked like was a skeleton. I didn't touch it, although I would have even then, but Joe gave a scream and ran, and I was scared. I wasn't long overtaking him, and from that time, Joe had a hard time to keep up with me. It followed and kept 20 feet behind us.
No.
There were bars on the home's fence. We jumped the bars, and the thing cut across the field to head us off, but we got there first. We stood in the doorway and watched it for half an hour. There was a stone wall with a rotten pole on top of it, and it stood on this pole. In the morning, I went out and felt the pole, and, do you know, it was so rotten it just crumbled up in my hands. Why, that pole was so rotten it couldn't have held a bird. As I said, I'll never forget that racket as long as I live. And as for Joe, he would never talk of it except to his mother and me. A year later, he was taken sick, and a while later he died, and he always claimed that this was a forerunner for him. We were both sure it couldn't have been anyone playing tricks because the moon was full and we could see everything as plain as day. Then, a strange thing happened. So Joe died of a tubercular throat, and he died hard, but he never rambled in his mind. It was always clear right to the end. But one day, not long before his death, Joe said to his mother, "My throat won't hurt me anymore. He, the apparition, was here and rubbed it." The pain had been almost more than he could bear, but from that moment it stopped, and he never felt it in his throat again. I sat up with him every night, and do you know what he looked like when he died? He looked just like that man, for he was pretty well wasted away. So that was the story that got me interested in forerunners and what that might mean.
I first of all, you are an amazing reader.
Oh, thank you.
I will say that you're probably too good because I would like to pee my pants. Like,
when I read that, I was like, I got the chills right up the back of my neck. Like, just the thought of, like, you know, we were all curious of things, and to go back and to kind of investigate this experience and to see this thing, and like the thought of it sitting up on this rotten pole that couldn't even hold the weight of a bird. Ooh.
Yeah. I have a very healthy sense of self-preservation.
Mm-hmm.
I would see that thing exactly once and be like, hey, buddy, Joe, let's vamoose. Let's head back to your way, your house, because it's the opposite direction that that thing is in.
Yeah.
And let's go to bed immediately and, like, let's draw all of the blinds. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a big nope
I
from
know.
Me.
It's so creepy. And, like, the fact that it came, like, crawling out at first on its hands and feet, like, it wasn't even standing up. And then it, like, stands up and it's, like, staring at them with these sunken eyes.
No, thank you. No bueno. Yeah. I will return this. I do not want this. Here's your receipt and here I go. Bye. Like,
yeah. Yeah. Oof. And like, I wonder, and it's interesting too, like it stood under a cherry tree across the street, but then the apple trees around them started shaking and dropping apples. Like what was...
Yeah, I was having a tough time following that because it's like, did he just call... like an apple tree a cherry tree, but it's like no, he's specifically talking about the apple trees around him.
Yeah. And it's hard too, because these were like, you know, told verbally. This was not like an edited document. This was like a story told to the author who took it and then just put it, and it's all in quotes, so it's like a, you know, quote.
Yeah, it's a told story.
Yeah. So,
and I mean, they didn't mention it, but, like, I am picturing this, like, you know, that rattling bone noise that sometimes comes with, like, children's horror, like, media?
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'm picturing,
bones?
So I am picturing, like, a little bit of that happening as well. And it's, like, it's just adding to it.
Yes, yeah. I can't,
And, like, he got his face up to it. Why?
Yeah.
Why would he put his face up to it?
I have
it?
No idea. He mustn't have felt like he. So not Joe. I don't know. I should have looked up the name of the man. But the man telling the story wasn't as scared as Joe because it wasn't his forerunner.
Yeah, it must have been. Yeah.
Yeah. So he didn't feel as frightened, but Joe was the one that took off because something in him knew.
Yeah. He yelped and vamoosed. Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah.
But I'm like, so he talked about going out to that post the next morning.
Yes.
And he's like, oh yeah, it was super rotted. Like it couldn't hold up the weight of a bird.
Yeah.
But I'm like, maybe it was strong. And then that thing sat on it.
It rotted it. It's, I mean,
and
maybe.
Yeah.
Like why was it still standing if it was that rotten? And he goes out and touches it and it crumbles.
Yeah, see, that seems very, like, mystical to me.
Yeah, like a stiff wind would have knocked that over.
Mm-hmm. And we have a few of those, especially up in Cape Breton.
Yes, exactly.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah, that is big spooky.
Yeah.
Very good story. Wow.
Yeah, I would definitely, like, if you guys can get a copy of Blue Nose Ghosts, I would totally recommend it. It's a lot of really good folklore in there. For around the area.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to look into that. Do you know if that's at the library out here?
Probably. I don't know for sure, but like I would not doubt it. It's a big part of our sort of, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, they have culture. Just a really good selection of local folklore stuff.
Yes.
So yes, I will definitely look into that.
So what do you have for us this evening?
Well, let me tell you what. I got it in my head.
Mm-hmm.
I came down to two stories.
Okay.
I was like, I'm either going to do a New Brunswick one, another New Brunswick one, or I'm going to head over to BEI because we've done New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and Newfoundland. So we'll do PEI this time.
Mm-hmm.
PEI, y'all got to loosen up on the ghost. Like, because I looked up just any kind of PEI ghost story, and like the ironclad grip that PEI has on its tourism, like, just I couldn't find anything. The only thing I could find, and I'm going to tell the story tonight, is the West Point Lighthouse.
Ooh.
And all of this comes from one telling of the story. So take this with a grain of salt. There is nothing to cross-reference. Nothing at all.
Okay.
On the West Point Lighthouse, official website, there's nothing about the ghosts. Like, there's nothing at all.
They save it for the tours.
I guess, or for you to, like, unwittingly go into yourself and experience. Yeah, imagine. So, as I mentioned before, this is a, like, there's no murder at all. Like, okay. this is not a dark story.
Okay.
Which makes sense, because it's a lighthouse, and you don't want it to be dark.
Yeah.
So, the West Point Lighthouse in PEI was built in 1875 and was in operation as a lighthouse until 1963, when the last keeper retired. And then it was converted into an inn in 1987. So it has a pretty short life as a lighthouse.
Yeah.
It stands at 69 feet tall. Nice.
Nice.
Nice. It is unique in its appearance because it has stark black and white stripes.
Oh.
Yeah, so it's a little bit different from what you'd usually see with, like, red or... No, I suppose you want to see blue, because that would blend into the sky too much.
Beetlejuice. But,
you
know,
you would typically see, like, yeah, you would typically see, like red stripes or
yes.
orange, like, something to pop from the sky. But, yeah, this has black and white stripes. So it also houses a museum that has a collection of local history, as well as the history of maritime lighthouses and their technology. If so, there's somebody in your family who's, like, really interested in lighthouses, or if you yourself are.
I am.
Yes, this is a great place to go, because you'll learn about the technology of lighthouses, especially pertaining to the area.
Nice.
The lighthouse only had two keepers in its history, William Anderson McDonald and Benjamin Benny McIsaac. The hauntings, unsurprisingly, revolve around lights. There have been many reports of people turning off the lights at night, and when they next enter or look into the room, the lights have been turned back on. So the only phantom apparition documented has been of the original keeper, William McDonald. He appears in the corner of the keeper's room, which is the original room that he would have stayed in while he worked there, which you can now rent out through the inn. And he'll watch the inn workers as they lock up at the end of the night. This room also has the most stories about lights turning on and off by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Carol Livingstone, who is the great-granddaughter to William McDonald, would spend much of her childhood at the lighthouse with her friends, following the then-current keeper, Benny McIsaac, around as he did his duties. There was a door in the lighthouse that was always kept shut, and when she and her friends would ask what was behind it, Benny would reply with, "You don't want to know."
Oh.
Yeah, so I'm like, that, at first glance, that's, like, dark, but yeah. I'm also like, that's just, like, some cheeky old man prank, where it's just yeah. like, oh, I'm just spooking the kids, it's actually yes. just my bedroom, and it's a mess in there.
Yeah.
When the inn first opened, the managers would stay overnight 5 nights a week, and then have volunteers come in to check on it for the last 2 days.
Oh, wow.
An unnamed volunteer told a story about how she had locked up the inn at 9 p.m. and then went to her car. When she got in her car, she saw that a light had been left on in a second floor room. She exited her car, went up to the room, turned off the light, and returned to her car, only to find that the same light had been turned back on. She was quoted as saying, "If there was anybody in there that wanted that light on that bad, they could darn well have it."
Really, though? It's like, I ain't going back in there.
Yeah, it's like, if they want it, they have it.
Yeah.
Which is, like, totally fair.
Yes.
A tourist from the U.S. visited the lighthouse in the early 1990s, not knowing the ghost stories. She says she was compelled to sit in a certain corner and write a poem. She insisted that it felt as though the poem was given to her.
Oof.
It was later revealed that the light that the volunteer had so much trouble with and the place where the tourist wrote the poem was the same corner where William McDonald's apparition... Was in the same corner where William McDonald's apparition is seen.
Is there a copy of the poem?
I do. I actually have it right here.
There once was a man from Nantucket.
So you read something, so I'm going to read something.
Okay, I'm ready.
So this poem is called West Point Light.
Okay.
On the sandy shore of PEI, you'll find the West Point Light, where it stood for 100 years or more, flashing in the night, to warn lonely sailors off the dangerous reef, always flashing to be sure no ship would come to grief.
Ah.
I've heard many stories of when the light was new, shipwrecks and buried treasures, and ghosts they had a few. How once a headless seaman walked the sands at night, searching for a phantom ship that never came in sight. When I was much younger and couldn't get to sleep, I'd count the flashings of the light instead of counting sheep. And every time I return, the old light seems to smile, welcome weary traveler, stop and rest a while. Then one day automation caught up to the light. It was different, and when the workmen finished, it was a different sight. The old home and the buildings were quickly torn down, leaving the light flashing lonely on the ground. The friendly lighthouse keeper quietly moved away, no more to greet the people that walk there every day. Now in my dreams I see him, with his ghostly lantern bright, climbing up the narrow stairs, once more to check his light.
Aww.
Yeah.
That's, like, kind of comforting, but, like, yeah, sad.
yes, for sure. And it makes me wonder if this tourist was from the area, but I'm also like, if she felt as though the poem was given to her, then she's not speaking with her own voice. She's speaking with probably a local's voice.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wonder, like, did it say anything about her? Like, was she a poet, or is this kind of like, you know, just this random person kind of got in this room?
From what I gathered, she's not a poet. She was from the southern U.S.
Mm-hmm.
She visited in the 90s. That's all that was offered. Like I said, like, this story all came from, like, one article.
Yes.
That was Carol Livingstone talking about her experiences and the experiences in the lighthouse.
Right.
So I am not sure what the line about the headless seaman is in reference to.
Yeah.
But there have been ghost ship sightings off the coast.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, I would love to do a ghost ship roundup for the Maritimes.
That'd be really cool. Because
we have so many ghost ships here.
Yeah, let's do that. That sounds like a good time.
And for what it's worth, the light of the lighthouse is still turned on. However, it is now electric. But it is strongly believed that William McDonald lets his presence be known to make sure the light is still being maintained and well taken care of.
Aww.
So that's, like... that's all I have on this lighthouse.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting.
Yeah, it's a very quick story. Like, PEI, you have to let your ghost flags be shown. Like,
maybe it just means we have to go on a road trip to gather some intel, ghostly intel.
Yeah. I will say, a little while ago, Google released a list of the creepiest haunted locations in Canada.
Ooh.
And this lighthouse did make it on that list.
Oh, wow. Well done.
Yeah. So there is something about this lighthouse that Google's like, this place is wild. This place is whack. Like, this is a plea for any listener from PEI to please email us with some local ghost stories for us to go through, because there's nothing on the official PEI websites. Like,
I know, it's scarce.
Yes, yeah. Like, I'm thinking of, there's like an official New Brunswick one called, like, My Haunted New Brunswick.
Oh.
If you go on mynewbrunswick.ca, I think, like, there's haunted locations, like, there's a tab. So New Brunswick leans right into it. I'm pretty sure Nova Scotia and Newfoundland also lead right into
it.
So
yeah.
PEI, like, y'all, like, ghosts can be wholesome.
Give up the ghost.
Give up the ghost. we don't have any listener stories, so again, please
send them
email
in.
Us Yes. We would love to read your stories on air. We do have like a lot of friends who are like, oh, we've got stories for you. And every time I'm like, email them in.
Send
like,
them to us.
Send them in. Yeah.
What is our email, Chrissy?
Our email is maritimesupernatural@gmail.com.
Perfect.
So do you have any relevant tales?
Well, I mean, I do have a smaller personal story that I have not told on the podcast.
Alrighty.
At one point, we lived in a very old farmhouse. It was about 115 years old. And I had always gotten the impression that, you know, we weren't alone in there. But obviously, it's an older house, so you kind of always kind of get that impression.
Totally, yeah.
The only time that anything made its presence known to me specifically was my mom used to work as a courier, and whenever she had to go to PEI, which I guess that's relevant, she would get my brother and I to go with her just for the drive, just, you know, spend some time together on the island. It's fun. And one night we came home after one of these excursions, and we get home super late. Like, it's 11, 12 o'clock at night. We go upstairs, and there's this little storage room that my brother and I, we would tease my mom by calling it the gateway to hell, because
it was so
tiny, and it was where like the entrance to the attic was. So like, you know, like it was like, oh, it's kind of creepy. It's kind of off-putting. But
I thought you were going to say, and it's where the devil comes through. So we just nicknamed it the gateway to hell.
Yeah, no, we mostly, like, it was like, yeah, it's kind of creepy looking, and we found out that calling it the gateway to hell, like, bugged our mom, so we're like, let's exploit this, because we are loving children.
Yes.
So, we like, when you go up the stairs, like, the gateway to hell is, like, right there to your right.
Yes.
And my mom had hung up, like, these really cute lace curtains on the door, like, the door frame, because it didn't have an actual door.
So, like, trying to make the area less spooky.
Exactly, yeah. Make it more welcoming.
Yeah.
And sitting right in front of the door...
Nope.
Was this little stuffed toy cat that I had gotten my mom... Yeah, that I had gotten my mom, like, years previous to, like, keep in her van. Like, this was when I was a little kid.
Yeah.
So, like, she wouldn't get lonely.
Oh, that's cute.
Something had dug that out. It was in a box in the gateway to hell. It had been dug out and just placed perfectly there, facing towards the stairwell.
Ugh.
So that as you came up, it was the first thing you see. Ugh. So going up the stairs, it was me and my mom. Like, I was ahead of my mom, and my brother was still down in the kitchen. And yeah. My brother's a prankster.
Okay.
So, you know, we're going up the stairs. We both stop, and we're both like, Alexander?
Yes, yeah.
Like, we were like, how did you put this here? Like, when did you put this here? Like, he was just like, we left right after school. Like, when would I have had time to put that there?
Ugh.
And it completely baffled us. We had no idea how it got there.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. We don't think that it was any malicious spirit. We were just like, oh, like, thinking back on it, I think it was just they wanted us to know that they were there.
Yeah.
And they were like, hey, maybe doing it this way won't creep them out too bad.
Because it's a comforting symbol.
Yeah, it's like, oh, it's a cute toy, and it was, you know, purchased and given with love. So
yeah.
Hey, maybe let's do this. Another thing is that we had this big cat decoration. It was really cute, but it had these two little beady black eyes.
Yeah.
And my family would prank each other by, like, leaving it outside of our bedroom doors just to, like, kind of startle, like, because, like, it was really off-putting, the little black eyes.
Yes, yeah.
So we would oftentimes put it at, like, the top of the stairs or the bottom of the stairs or outside of bedroom doors. A common one was my brother and I would put it in our mom's bed. So, like, she would go to bed, pull back her covers, and there
oh,
it was.
No.
We do that all the time with, like, all of our, like, creepier toys. So I'm like, maybe the spirit saw us doing that with, like, the, like, the decoration and was like, I want to join in.
Yeah.
And I was like, aww. Oh, no, I'm sorry, sweetie. You can't join in.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's cute.
So, yeah. Yeah. So that's the story that I'm offering up today.
Yeah. It's cute. I like that one.
Yeah. It was really sweet.
It's like a nice note to end on.
It was a really sweet gesture. I do feel bad that it probably was not received as well as any spirit might have wanted us to receive it.
if they had positive intentions and it scared you guys, that's probably why they didn't do much else.
Yes, yeah.
It's like, well, we scared them.
Yeah.
Never mind.
I will say that when my mom was looking at this house to buy it, she said, like, this was afterwards when we were talking about what may have put the toy cat there. She was in what we now refer to as the gateway to hell, and she said that she smelled something weird.
No.
And she couldn't quite place it, but she thought, well, you know, it's an old house, it has weird smells, whatever.
Yes.
She later found out that, hey, weird smells can often be a sign of a haunting. And yes. Then this happens, and mom was like, oh, we have a ghost. Like, oh, man. Yeah. Ah, nuts.
Oh, farts.
Ah, beans. So thank you all so much for joining us today. And like I said, this goes up on the 26th. So I'll actually just be coming back from Disney. So I was going to say, hey, if you hear my voice and you recognize me, say hi. But I'll be in a vehicle, so please don't say hi. Oh,
that would be...
I love all of you so much. Don't say hi to me when I'm in a vehicle.
You know what, though? That would make for a good story for the podcast.
That's true. Y'all, please don't. But yeah, so you can find us online on Twitter and Instagram at MSN Podcast. You can also now follow us on YouTube. I set up a YouTube where I'm posting all of the episodes there, as well as on Spotify, because I know not everybody has Spotify or can access the podcast on there. Mm-hmm. I am also intending in November to put up the episodes on iTunes and Google Play, so there will be more places for you to be able to get these episodes.
Woohoo!
Keep following us on social media, and you will find where to find these things. And send in your stories to maritimesupernatural@gmail.com. Maritime Supernatural is all one word. There is no punctuation except for where you would expect it. And we will see you again in 2 weeks. Actually, I said in 2 weeks, but no, we will see you again later this week for the spookening. So send in your stories, follow us on Twitter. We'll have more information. We want to make it really special for our first Halloween special.
I'm excited.
Yay. All right.
I love you.
I love you. Rip in peace.